I'm Chris Renwick. This is my dad, Tom. We're grain and oilseed farmers just outside of Wheatley, Ontario in Chatham, Kent. I'm a seventh generation farmer. We live on our farm with my mom and dad, my wife, Rachel, and my three kids, Shawn, Melyse, and Sadie.
My ancestors came here almost 200 years ago in 1820. We're looking forward to an anniversary coming up, and we're hoping that the generations continue to follow along behind us, and maybe in another 200 years, we'll make it to 400.
I've been working with my dad probably since I was 5 or 6 years old out in the field. Sitting behind the seat in the tractor was probably where I spent a lot of time when I was younger. About the age of 14 or 15, was able to start doing some of the work out in the field. And it's slowly progressed over the last 25 years. Working with family always has its challenges. Sometimes everybody gets a little emotional and a little upset. And the next time you might be sitting having a birthday party at the table.
In the last 50 years, the changes have been going from 300 acres to 750 acres, from a combine with a 12-foot head on it to a combine with a 30-foot head on it. You can't do it with the same machinery you did years ago. Everything is bigger. We can get a lot of work done in a short period of time.
So usually in the morning, we try to talk about what's going to happen that day to see whether there's things that we need to get done. Morning.
Howdy doody. How are you?
Good. I just thought I'd get the combine out here and take a look at a few things before we get into bean season here in the next couple months. We finished our wheat harvest in July, looking forward to soybeans in early October, and followed by our grain corn coming off in late October to early November. We got a good rain last night, and that's the second one we've had in the last few days, so maybe we should go take a look at the beans over there.
Looks like it's going to be a beautiful day, though, to do something.
Some of the time we need to go out and check the fields and see what's going on. I like to take my son, Shawn, with me when I get a chance. Okay, Shawn, we're going to go over and take a look at these beans over here. Grandpa and I were talking about maybe we should put a fungicide on these since we've been getting some rain the last few days. He seems to be like a sponge right now, so I want to make sure that I'm giving him accurate information and making sure that he's up to speed, because he's only 8 right now, but I can see in his future that he's very interested in what goes on the farm, and he wants to follow me around a lot.
One of these days you're going to have to check all this out by yourself and make the decisions on it.
Hopefully we don't find too much over there that we have to look after. Looks like our weed control this spring worked real well. The products that we use seem to have kept the weeds down the way we want them, so that's a good start. Current day-to-day challenges are resistant weeds are becoming more and more of a problem. We're having to fight those weeds more often, and some of the products that we were using before where we could use them on every acre have had to be changed because those weeds are being more and more of a challenge all the time.
The beans get taller, there's more canopy, and the airflow through the crop just isn't there anymore. So fungicides become a priority.
We want to make sure we protect this crop because it looks like it's a good crop coming, and we've been getting some rain here the last couple of days that maybe we weren't expecting, so we want to make sure that we keep it protected as much as we can. Okay, let's head out.
Yep.
Did you get that jug of fungicide?
Yeah, I got it right here.
Okay. Well, let's get some water in this tank and we'll get it ready to go. Okay, let's go get that fungicide application on this bean field. These beans are looking good over here. So I'm just thinking maybe we should put on about 20 gallons of water per acre. We should maybe put the water volume up just a little bit.
Yeah.
We did a lot of tilling the soil before to try to control the weeds. And now with the introduction of more herbicides in the market, we're able to spray the field, not have to work it, and now the planters today are giving us the opportunity to do that in one pass. Cuts down on erosion, we're able to keep the soil structure better, we're able to keep the organisms in the soil working better, we're able to not use as much diesel fuel, and time.
What are these lines from?
I think they're from last year's planter tracks going through. I came out here the other day to take a look, and I noticed that we got quite a chunk that we lost this year. So it looks like we're losing another few feet. So last year when we planted, we were able to plant right up to the side here, and now we had to back up. In some cases, we lose maybe a couple feet every year, or sometimes we lose a big chunk, and in this case, it looks like we've lost a big chunk. Unfortunately, the shoreline erosion is something that we can't do a whole lot about. We would like to be able to control that, but cost-wise and regulations would probably impede us from being able to do those types of things that we need to do to keep it under control.
We lose property every year. That doesn't make us any money. So we got to be very careful as what we do on our soil erosion.
Sometimes the water crashing against the bank and on the bottom, and the cliff dropping off of that. Sometimes they say that it's more the moisture that's coming out of the hill from the gravel ridge and running underneath that's actually taking the moisture and pulling it out. So somehow we need to try to do what we can to make sure that the next 200 years is able to farm here on our family farm.
When my ancestors got here, they decided to put a cemetery on them. There's only a few along on this area that are family cemeteries. Only the families are buried there. So I've seen five generations on this farm. My grandfather, my dad, myself, Chris, Shawn, and the girls. And that's something to, for five generations to that I can say I've seen living right here.
My grandfather lived to be 91, and he was buried there in 2015. So about 3 years ago, he passed away. And when he passed away, we brought the funeral coach through the yard here and kind of did the little horseshoe and in front of the barn, and we did a little stop in front and brought him over to the cemetery. And the funeral director said to us, he didn't think he'd ever brought anyone home before. And I guess at some point, I'll probably be brought home. I remember when my grandfather moved to Leamington, he said to me, he said, you know, you don't live somewhere for 86 years and just get up and leave. And that's something that I hope happens to me. I hope that one of my children decide that they want to farm, whether it's my son or one of my two daughters that want to look after the farm when it's their turn. I hope that they can continue to enjoy what it's like to be able to be on the farm. People ask us sometimes why we farm. It's one of those things that being exposed to it at a young age is probably a big part of it, but they always say that if you don't enjoy farming, you're probably not going to stay with it. If you don't enjoy being out there in the field, watching the crop grow, it's probably not for you. But we try to do our best to make sure that we're producing a clean, healthy product that goes to the world to feed the world.